state, despite the percentages I told you a little while ago about why this is not necessarily a great economic benefit for the state, in their current development plan, was looking at mining as a potential vocation for the state. But we can't find out, right? This has been in place for 4 years, and we don't know what's been done with this state mining program. We can't even find out who's on the mining board. There's no transparency, there's no accountability for what's going on. Even though the state bond conference does not have a lot of mining right now, and despite the fact that we've just been through this horrible recession, the economy here has actually been growing in the last 7 years, predominantly from the tourism and service sector. The majority of people who live in the state work in that service sector and in tourism and the direct and indirect pieces of it. And even though the direct piece is relatively small, the tertiary, secondary and tertiary services of supporting hotels, supporting restaurants, supporting transportation, et cetera, all make a big difference, right? Now, don't get me wrong, tourism is not perfect for the environment. I am not saying that. But for the long-term health of the state, it should be synergistic with natural resource protection because that's what people come here to see. And it is potentially good for the economy over a longer term than mining ever is. So in this few years, we've seen less than 2% of the area of this municipality under a mining concession for exploration move up to over 16%. We've seen more surface area under exploration, and we're very worried about the direction this is going. BCS is not the most attacked state when it comes to mining, but that may argue that folks see it as a great opportunity because it doesn't have a very dense population to oppose. But why should we do mining when the state is in remarkably good shape, right? This Baja California Sur has the lowest poverty rates, highest education rates, greatest life expectancy, greatest number of doctors and nurses of any state in Mexico. This is a remarkable accomplishment and achievement, and we're setting up the vocation of tourism against the vocation of mining for the future of the state. And we can compare it to Zacatecas, which has the big mining and the highest poverty and the lowest life expectancy. Why is this? It is because of what we all call the curse of natural resources. Developing countries who take their gold, other minerals, oil and gas, and exploit it don't get rich. The people of those countries don't get rich. Even if you look at the Middle East, very few people get rich. The ore is taken out of the ground, it may or may not be processed here. And if you've driven by Santa Rosalia this last week, you see the boat there. The Koreans are loading copper ore onto a boat and they're taking it somewhere else, right? They're not creating jobs here for processing copper, creating wire, or you know, gutters for fancy homes in the mine in Washington, D.C., where we need gutters. The benefits leave the place where the minerals are. The revenue goes somewhere else. The benefit is about 5 pesos per hectare. It's nothing, right? It's just not worth it, even at the tax revenue level for what we're doing. Oxfam is an international development agency based in London, and they've looked at mining and the social impacts of mining, and you know, concluded that globally, mining interferes with access to food and water. It is bad for women. It reduces access to land and other opportunities. So what about Loretto, right? In Loretto, the town passed a OED, an ecological ordinance, and it's one of the first ones in Mexico. It is forward-thinking, it looks at how we're going to manage, it looks at sustainable uses. The POEL have not been tested in the courts. Right? We need to understand whether they will withstand legal challenge by mining companies. We need to understand whether the design of them here, which emphasizes water and other protections, will stand up against the overriding claim that minerals are the thing that win. We have regional development programs that, combined with POEL, talk about, you know, you can't dump mine waste in certain places, you can't put it too close to water, you can't extract material. Now, all of this is stuff that the municipality and the regional governments can control, which is what goes on the surface. So they're doing their best to design this in a way that makes it difficult to go mining. Because even if you got the right to take the minerals out, if you can't do anything on the surface, once you get them out, you've got a problem. So the goal of these local protections was, you know, to make this a challenging place to go mining so people will go somewhere else. And we have to remember that we're basically setting up, you know, the importance of water, which belongs to all the people of Mexico and is controlled by the federal government, against minerals that get the same treatment. And so we've got all these examples of how we're going to ask people to deal with mining waste, open pits, the water I mentioned, the tailings I mentioned, going forward. You could imagine, therefore, that an open pit copper mine, such as proposed here, that we put something like this, probably wouldn't pass review. We would hope it wouldn't pass review. But we don't necessarily get that choice, because the decision about mining is made by the feds, and the decision about surface management is made more locally. In addition, the laws that we're dealing with here, the POEL and the Regional Urban Development Plan, aren't perfect, right? And then give and take of negotiation to get it passed and get the City Council to sign it, language was put in that made it a little bit more flexible, a little bit more vague, the more interpretation. There's language in a few places that said, if the appropriate official decides, then da da da. Well, that's, you know, an exception that you can drive a truck through, right? And so we have to worry about whether the appropriate official will make the right decision, not that the appropriate official is guided by the law. There isn't a single regime that governs mining, but there is this preference and desire for mining. And so in addition to the sort of how do these concessions get done, how do permits for mining get done, what's the local law, we also want to think about all the other laws that are in place in this area. Right? And here's a partial list that are all numbered number one. For no apparent reason. Maybe I like all of them. So, when Las Palomas did their environmental impact study, they didn't necessarily talk about the forest land use laws. They didn't necessarily talk about the permits to use explosives. They were talking about what they were going to do specifically, and we have to think about applying who's going to make sure that an EIA is well read, well studied, and all these other laws that may or may not apply are considered when authorities review a mine. You know, did the authorities even think about the biosphere reserves at El Arco, El Baleo, and Los Coronados? We don't know, right? We don't even have the record to necessarily show us what the facts. I think we also need to think about how we convince the state that, okay, you spent 4 years exploring whether this was a good location or not, and all the evidence seems to indicate that it's not a good vacation, so let's drop it. We also need to figure out how we're regulating the mines that we do have, and we need to make sure that the rule of law is applied, whether it's that whole suite of laws, or the OLs, or the local regulations, or biosphere reserve agreements and such that everyone has put in place. We have economic arguments. This is not good for the economy. We have social arguments that it's not good for people, not good for women, not good for access. That shouldn't be a choice that is made in this circumstance. And I think that we have to watch and understand what's going on. Mark is going to pass out a little flyer that has our contact information on it, but it also has a URL for a donation page on the Ocean Foundation's website, so that anybody who's a U.S. citizen or has a U.S. source of income can make a donation if they wish. Our intent is to raise money to support public interest lawyers who are paying attention to these environmental impact studies, who are watching what's going on with the application of law, who will challenge some of these things in the courts, make sure that the right questions are asked when they need to be asked. We're going to support organizations like Pico Alianza Loreto and others who can help talk to the community, talk to the ranchers, talk to landowners, and understand what risks they are taking. We also need to do more research and understand who these companies are, who owns them, where they're capitalized from, what's going on with them, and challenge them in the United States, in Canada, in Australia, through public media and such, that they can't, you know, take advantage of Baja California and the state of Baja California for an exploitative mineral gain that is going to harm everyone. And this is going to be, you know, something where we need to prepare now, right? The companies haven't spent a lot of money to get an exploration concession. So challenging them and putting brakes on now is important, rather than wait when they've got an exploitation permit and having earth moving equipment moved here and have spent a lot more money. So I would encourage all of you to think about this as an opportunity to say something now rather than when it's too late. And think about what the opportunities are to, you know, this community passed a really forward-thinking set of laws with the OL and regional management with water in mind, and water at the center of that ecological ordinance. How can we help defend that? And it was done without a protest or fight, right? This was consensus. This whole community came together and got this ordinance passed. And I think it's a really remarkable thing that is great.